In this part, we're going to initially focus on stability circles and talk about how we can start making a trade-off between optimum input matching for maximum power transfer, design of the input matching network for good noise performance, and also designing the input matching network for stability. First of all, look at the input stability circles. These input stability circles are plotted on the gamma S plane. And what this is telling us is that gamma S must be in this region for there to be stability. In fact, it's not that restrictive. It's actually saying that at 2 GHz, we could possibly be unstable if gamma S is in this region. What we want is we want our amplifier to be unconditionally stable. In terms of the input stability that we're looking at here, we want the amplifier to be stable no matter what the load is. If the antenna is suddenly disconnected, we want our circuit to be stable, for example. At 2 GHz, we want to be outside this circle, anywhere in this region. And this is 2 GHz, and then we gradually increase in 2 GHz steps up to 30 GHz. So here's our 30 GHz stability circle. We want to avoid being inside this region at 30 GHz. Well, getting back to our frequencies that we're really interested in, 2, 4, 6, 8, it is this stability circle. This is the 10 GHz circle, and this is the 12 GHz circle. Well, you can see here that if we just look at the 8 GHz circle, yes, we could be stable if gamma S is out here, but gamma S is not going to radically change. So realistically, we really need to have a gamma S that's inside here. When we're out of band, we want to make sure that our gamma S is well away from these circles. We want to make sure that our amplifier is stable out of band as well as in band. Those are our input stability circles. We can do a similar thing looking at the output stability circles. This is on the gamma L plane. We want our circuit to be stable no matter what gamma S is. And so we must be outside these circles. This dashed line is telling us which side of the circle is unstable. Previously, we looked at designing the input matching network for maximum power transfer just looking at S11. And so we have S11 conjugate. Then we had NF min for the minimum noise figure. And if we superimpose stability, so I'm going to superimpose stability now, we see that this S11 conjugate is not a good choice. Our circuit would not be unconditionally stable if we chose our input matching network so that the input reflection coefficient followed that S11 conjugate. We see that our minimum noise figure is on the edge of stability. So we would probably want to at least be in here. And if we have a locus for our input matching network reflection coefficient just inside, we're going to have a very small trade-off on NF min, a little bit bigger trade-off on the optimum design for maximum power transfer or gain. Let's get away from talking about the optimum design of the input matching network for maximum power transfer and start talking about gain. We have noise figure circles. We have stability circles. Is there something similar for gain? And the answer is yes, there is. As humans, we're not going to draw these circles. We're going to let our CAD tools draw these circles for us. For maximum available gain, we do have a little issue because sometimes our amplifier does not have a maximum available gain because it would be unstable. CAD tools generally define Gmax, which is the maximum available gain when we have stability, but when the circuit is unstable, Gmax is just equal to GMS. Here are our gain circles for maximum available gain for our design. This is the gamma S plane. It's a little bit richer than just looking at S11 conjugate. What this is saying is that we could have gamma S anywhere on this circle at 7 GHz, and we will have the same Gmax value, a Gmax of 17 dB. Remember, our design target is 14 dB. So we have plenty of room to trade off here. When we go up to 14 gigahertz, we're at 14.1 dB. That's a little bit outside our range. This is 12 gigahertz. We have 14.8 dB of maximum available gain. And so we have a very small trade-off that we need to make. These Gmax circles indicate that there's actually quite a range of gamma S. And perhaps we could detune from that optimum input matching network designed for maximum power transfer. We detune it. We keep the gain the same because we change our output matching network, but we can get closer to the minimum noise figure point. Now, what we saw on the previous slide is that we really cannot be right at NF min because we're on the edge of stability. We need to increase the noise a little bit. That is, we need to choose our input matching network, the gamma S of our input matching network, a little bit smaller in magnitude so we're closer in to get away from the edge of stability defined by the stability circles. This is one way of looking at maximum available gain. We're looking at the maximum available gain at several frequencies. Another way of looking at maximum available gain is to pick on a frequency and look at what the locus will be for gamma S when we offset the gain by certain amounts, in this case in 1 dB steps. Gmax at 10 GHz is 15.5 dB, and these circles indicate what gamma S can be for 1 dB trade-offs in the gain. So this first circle indicates what the gain will be at Gmax, which is 15.5 dB. This circle here is when we're 1 dB lower at 14.5 dB. And we see our 14 dB number is probably going to be around about here. So we actually have quite a lot of trade-off space. We would like these circles to intersect the NF min circles. We're going to pick an optimum noise figure and optimum gain, and hopefully everything is simultaneously met while still being outside those stability circles, still being in the stable region. In summary, these circles enable a trade-off of stability and noise and gain performance. We focus mostly on the input matching network because that is the first one that you design. Once you've designed that, you then move on and design the output matching network. And if you really want to, you could go back and refine the input matching network design. But at that point, you may be able to go and use optimization tools. We're focused on the input matching network. There is a similar development for the design of the output matching network.